Good morning. Good morning, Word of Life. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our first song today is Raise a Hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah. Hallelujah is the highest form of praise. So when we sing this song, I want everybody to sing from the depths of their heart, from their lungs. I want everybody to raise a hallelujah and raise the roof off the building. Amen. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah.
Our weapon is a melody.
I raise a hallelujah. Everything inside of me, I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of a mystery.
In the middle of Thank you.
the King. I bow before 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 the King. Thank you, Jesus. I bow before the King. Bow before the King. You're everything to me. Amen, amen. This last song I like to call up my niece, Sister Ayanna Davis, to sing with me on this song. Amen. Let's encourage her as she comes up. You deserve
So you came and changed my life. Yes. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. To die for.
So you sacrifice your life so I can be free. Because I am free.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Woo. Oh, that was a blessing. That was a blessing. Y'all are all worth saving. All of y'all. Those online, y'all are worth saving. And y'all say, how? How are we worth saving? Well, God's word says he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall have eternal life. All of y'all. Y'all here for a reason. You're online for a reason. Because you're worth saving. You're worth it to him. You're worth his life. You're worth the shed of his blood. You're worth the sacrifice. And he's instilled that in y'all. Amen. Let us bow. Father God, we give you thanks for this day, Lord. Thank you, Father, for seeing us worthy to be saved, Father God. For coming down and saving us, Lord, through your Son, Lord Jesus Christ, Father God. We thank you for this beautiful day that you have made, Father. As we dedicate this beautiful child to you today, Father God, we raise her up to you, Lord. And we teach her in the ways of the Lord, Father God, so she will not derail off the path, Father God. We thank you, Father. We thank you for this blessing. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for giving us the way, the truth, the life, and everything that comes with it, Father God. Lift up pastor to you right now, Father God, praying that you just, your Holy Spirit falls upon him right now, Father God, as he relays the word to us. May we ingest it. May we sit on it, and may it simmer in our bellies, Father God. May it simmer in our souls, and may we use it and pertain it to our life, Father God, and may we teach it to others. May we radiate today, Father God, your light. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And I would like to dismiss our youth and our children as we have our pastor come up.
Amen. Let's give God another hand clap of praise. Amen. Give him another hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Come on, people of God. Give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. As we celebrate the victory that the Lord has gotten us on this day. Amen. Over the years, he has kept us. He has carried us. He has protected us. He has been with us through every storm. Amen. Every situation that we have encountered in our lives, the Lord has been on our side. And I'm glad about it. I don't know about you, but I'm happy he saved my soul. Amen. Anybody else in here excited that the Lord has saved your soul? Amen. He saved my soul. He healed my body and made me whole. Amen. And that's why I serve him, because even though the world thought so less of me, and I thought so less of myself at times, he thought I was worth saving. Amen. And so let's give Sister Erica and Sister Nana a hand this morning. We praise God for them. Amen. And the expression of our praise to him through singing and clapping our hands and raising our hands and standing to our feet and yelling hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. And so good morning to all of you, to those of you who are watching us online. Good morning to you. And we want to encourage you to share the YouTube link with about 5 other people that you know. Ones whom God lay upon your heart, just share the link. We want to increase the attendance of God's people, amen, because we need to be in attendance, present, amen, with the body of believers so that we could hear a word from the Lord. It is always, to me, a privilege to be able to hear a word from God because it shows me that God is extending His grace, that God, it is an act of grace of God that He will speak through those whom He has chosen to expound on His word to us, amen, to speak to us, to continue to give us information, give us wisdom from on high, show us how we should be living, correct some things that we are doing wrong, right? And to affirm some things that we believe in and that we're standing upon. So I would never take this moment for granted. Amen. It is a blessed privilege to stand before you. And also, even if I'm sitting in the congregation, God is speaking. And it's the hour where God gets to say something to us. And we take what He's given us and apply it to our life. And so I'm excited again this morning. And so today I'm going to deviate from our doctrinal series, and I want to focus on our beautiful occasion at hand this morning. Amen. We're happy to be able to perform our first baby dedication here at Word of Life Christian Fellowship. And so it's a privilege and an honor for me to be able to perform this ceremony for baby Leah Kennedy Alexander. Amen. Kennedy, Leah was the second baby born into our church fellowship. Amen. And so I'm excited about that. And then I'm excited too because of my ties to this family. Amen. I've been knowing Chrishell all her life. Amen. I've known her all of her life. I've known her mother, Christina, since she was a little bitty child. Amen. And so I just, you know, really adore the spirit that Christina's mother and Chrishell's grandmother had, amen, when she was with us. And very, very beautiful spirit. And when I see Christina, I still see her mother, amen. And so I know she's smiling down, and this is a great honor for me and a privilege to have this connection of longevity with this family, amen. And so because of this, I feel that as a church, we're not going into our fourth year of administration. And as a church, as we do things for the first time, I see it important to at least talk about it, you know, to explain the significance of what we're doing and why we do what we do in the body of Christ. And so there are some scriptures that I want to call your attention to, and that is the gospel according to Matthew, verses 13 through 15. The Bible gives us many exhortations and encouragements about children. And as you turn there's one in particular, Psalms 127 and 3 reminds us that our children are heritage from the Lord and the fruit of the womb a reward. Psalms 8:2 says, out of the mouth of babes and infants you have established strength. And then one of the famous ones, Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way that he should go, even when he is old, he will not depart from it. And so there are many scriptural exhortations regarding our children and instructions that God has given us in way by way of encouraging us to raise our children and the proper training for them. But if you look at Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 through 15, and I don't purpose to be before you long, I just want to give some brief encouragement to all of us today. Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 through 15. And the word of God reads as follows. that some children were brought to him so that he might lay hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, "Let the children alone, and do not hinder them from coming to me, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Yes, after laying hands on them, he departed from there. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. There are other scriptural references that tells this particular account of a day in the life of Jesus. There is the account that Mark gives and the account that Luke gives. And the details are basically the same, but there are some things that are distinctive in the passages. And I will harmonize them or share them with you as I go through the message today. But I want to take my thought from where he says, "Do not hinder them from coming to me." And I want to talk about bring your children to the Lord. Bring your children to the Lord. And I want to encourage this as a practice among people of faith. To do this when they are infants. To do it when they are small. Because too often we wait till our children or teenagers, you know, or young adults to decide to bring them to the Lord. But there is a need to bring our children to the Lord when they are small. Yes. Amen. It's proper to for people of faith to bring up your child in the way of faith, so that through that training, they are being taught to love God, they're being taught to trust God, they are being taught to depend on God, they are being taught the significance of God and everything that we have come to understand and know about God ourselves. We pour that into our children. It's like this is the greatest legacy that we could pass to our children from generation to generation to generation, wherein our children, our children's children, our children's children's children, and so on, may pass on this legacy of faith, not necessarily leaving them behind a material inheritance, which that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Be nice. But to give something that is of a lasting legacy, a spiritual legacy that stores up treasures in heaven for them, this is great. This is going to be helpful for them because when they grow up and they start facing hardship in life, they're going to need that faith to lean on. When they grow up and they start going through challenges and suffering and pain, heartache, heartbreaks, making mistakes that, you know, cause them to suffer losses, they're going to need to know that they could turn to God. They're going to need to have their own personal relationship with God, so that they can lean and depend on the God that you lean and depended upon. And trust me that they're going to go through some of the same, down the same roads that you've been down when you were their age. It's coming. And so how do we prepare them for it? Because sometimes we may look at our life and we say, well, we wasn't prepared for this journey. But we can now prepare our children for it. Why? Because we want them to do it better than us. We want them to have a greater experience than we had. We don't want them to make the same choices that we made. And so to connect them with God is a beautiful thing. And it is something that we should never neglect. And so the question this morning here is, what does it mean to bring your children to the Lord? In a simple sense, it means to dedicate your children to the Lord or to seek God's favor and protection for your children. That's the simple definition. It means to dedicate your children to the Lord or to seek God's favor and protection for your children. Yes, sir. But in a technical sense, it means to honor God by giving the child back to Him. It means to honor God by giving the child back to Him as a sign of acknowledging His ownership and His sovereign will over your own and even over the will of the child. Yes, sir. And so we understand as stewards, the principle of stewardship is that we're just managers over something that God owns. And so as managers, it is proper for us to be able to manage what God has given us according to God's desire. And so it is to honor God by giving the child back to Him as a sign of acknowledging His ownership and His sovereign will over our own, as well as the will of the child. At the end of the day, Leah belongs to the Lord, but have been entrusted to Chriselle and William. And so it is also pledging to raise the child the way God has prescribed in His word. Yes, sir. So when you bring your child to the Lord, if this is what you're saying, you say, God, I pledge this child to You to raise this child in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. And it has to be something that we understand, because our will gets crossed up with God's will, and even sometimes the will of the child gets conflicting with God's will. Because the things that God would have for these children, we oftentimes do what we want to do with them. And so it's dedicating your child to the Lord to seek God's favor and protection for your child. It means to honor God by giving the child back to Him as a sign of acknowledging His ownership and sovereignty and sovereign will over our will, and as well as over the will of the child. It is pledging to raise the child in the way that God has prescribed in His word. And then lastly here, we need to understand, is whenever we bring our children to the Lord, it is our way of showing that we acknowledge that our children are lent to us. They are a gift from the Lord. And we admit that we need God's help in raising and caring for our children. That's what we do. When we bring our children to the Lord, that's just what we're saying. We're saying, God, I acknowledge that this is Your child. This is a gift from You. This is a reward from the womb, Father God, and You have entrusted this child into my care. But God, I'm also admitting that I don't know what to do. And I don't know how to do this without Your help. So God, help me. That's what it means. And so for us to get to this point in bringing our children to the Lord, there are three things that are required. One, submission, surrender, and spirituality. Submission means that parents must submit to God's sovereignty. If we're not submitted to God's sovereignty, then I don't think that we're going to encourage our children to do so. We also must surrender. Parents must resist selfish will and embrace the will of God. Okay, I want my child to be an astronaut. I want my child to be a cheerleader. I want my child to be a professional football player. I want my child to be a lawyer or a doctor or a scientist. I want my child to be someone famous and someone great. But do we ask, what does God want for my child. And it has to be something above all those things that we desire. And then there has to be spirituality, and that's important because parents must be able to comprehend God's overarching plan for all of humanity. And this includes using our children for his divine purpose. I thought about this, and I'm going to talk about Jesus in a minute, but I want to start here. The Spirit will give this to me. So can you imagine Mary when she had conceived Jesus by the Holy Spirit and her beginning to understand what Jesus was born to do?
Yes.
You know, many of us would have taken a selfish, you know, turn or approach, you know, because we don't want to give our child up to do anything that is outside what we desire for them. But it also teaches me, just like Jesus, just like Samson, Samuel, I'll talk about him as well, and Moses, and all of the children in the Bible that we read about who were preserved for particular purposes and reasons for the good of humanity. We must not remove the thought ever that our children has been excluded from that particular calling. And so we give them back to God. We bring them to the Lord because God has a special use and purpose for every human being that enters into the world. And so our obligation as parents, grandparents, guardians, godparents, family, friends, churches, is to groom that child from the moment that they come into this world. Groom that child, raise them up in the fear and admonition of the Lord, teach them the things that God has passed down to us and commanded us to pass down to them so they can begin to serve their purpose. That's what this is about. And so we bring our children to the Lord. And why? Because one, Jesus was brought to the Lord when he was a baby. And so if Jesus was brought to the Lord and had to be dedicated to the Lord, then what exempts our children from being brought to the Lord and dedicated to the Lord? So Jesus sets the example for what our living experience and our practices ought to be, right? So we ought to follow that. And so Jesus was brought to the Lord and he was dedicated. And then also one of the interesting things we find out about Jesus in the first chapter of, well, the second chapter of Luke, verses 46 through 49, is when Jesus was 12 years old. So we see Jesus at 12 years old hanging out in church. And so how did Jesus get to this point where he has an interest in being in the church at 12 years old? He had to have been raised that way and it had to have been instilled in him.
Yes.
And so he's there. They go on this trip. He's there. They lose him for 3 days. They can't find him. And then when they go look for him, guess where he was? He was in the temple. And he was sitting down with teachers, both listening and asking questions. And when his mother found him, she said, why did you do this? Me and your father were worried about you. And Jesus said, you should have known that I must be in my father's house.
Yes.
And isn't that beautiful?
Yes, sir.
For our children?
Yes.
That they grow to love being in the house of God. They grow to love being under the teachings of God. And then, you know, I really believe that many children, and the ones that we don't get to see all the time, and the ones that don't go to church every Sunday, I believe that many of them probably have a desire. But the parents doesn't always deem it to be important to bring them. And then when that child gets old, that child gets older, then that child becomes accustomed to not being in the presence of the Lord. That child becomes accustomed to not reading their Bibles every day. That child becomes accustomed to not engaging in spiritual conversation or watching spiritual content or listening to spiritual music, right? They don't grow into that accustomed. And then what happens is they become influenced by the things that are in the world, the music in the world, the TV shows in the world, the people of the world, the teachings of the world. And then they start getting in trouble. And then guess what we do? We try to bring an 18-year-old kid to the Lord. They grown now. I'm not saying that it's too late, but you get my point. It has to be something that the word says, train them up. That means you have to prep them for it. You have to prepare them for it. And so as we look at our passage here, and I'm going to go ahead and walk through this, because there are some principles in here that we find. And the question is, again, why do we bring our children to the Lord? One is because Jesus was brought to the Lord. And then the second answer is because the Lord instructs us to bring our children to the Lord. And this is what we see here in this 19th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus was encountering people as he always does, healing, teaching, mending brokenness, giving sight to blind eyes, helping people walk, helping people talk, and he's doing all of this. And it's amazing to me that in the midst of all of this, people start bringing children. And when I saw this, the first thing that came to my mind is we have to remember that God loves children. And that church is not just about grown-ups, but it's about children. And so we bring our children to the Lord because the Lord instructs us in the word. This is what he says again in Matthew 19:14. He says, do not hinder them from coming to me. Mark tells the same account of this story, but he says the words different and they mean the same. Mark 10:14, he says, permit the children to come to me. Yes. Means allow them to come to me. Bring the children to me, right? And the question is, in this text, who were the ones bringing the children? It was their parents. It was the parents that was bringing the children to the Lord. And you find that in the Gospel of Luke, when Luke gives his account, and he says that, and they were even bringing their babies. And so when it says they were even bringing their babies, I also began to think that they had to have brought themselves too.
Yes. Amen.
Yes.
You know, and it's this funny thing. I tell people this story, you know, me and my wife, we have grandchildren. And man, we're learning that grandchildren are just the prize, right? And one day I decided that I was going to surprise my father. I drove all the way to Louisiana, didn't tell my father I was coming. I went by myself, drove all the way there, got to the door. I knocked on the door. My dad opened the door and he said, hey. My stepmother comes to the door and she said, hey, son. And they doing like this. They say, where are the children? And I said, oh, it's just me. I wanted to surprise you. And they say, man, don't ever come down here without the children. And this is what I say to parents who show up on Sundays without their children.
Amen.
Don't ever come to church without your children. Because Jesus loves children too. Jesus said, bring the children to me. Children are an inheritance from the Lord. So don't ever show up here without your children. Amen. Bring those kids with you. Amen. Bring them with you. And so it is the parents who were bringing the children to the Lord. And they were bringing the children to the Lord so that Jesus could lay hands on them and so that Jesus could pray for them. And whenever we see instances of Jesus laying hands, or the Bible talks about laying hands on people, we see that there are three common reasons why God will have hands laid on someone, or we will lay hands on someone. One is for healing. Two is for blessing them. And three, it is for ordaining them. You see, when Jeremiah the prophet was ordained to do the work that the Lord had given him to do as a prophet, he said, I have ordained you before you were even in the womb. I saw you before your mother knew your daddy. You know what I'm saying? And so it is important for us to think like that, to realize that baby, God has a purpose for that baby. And I want to protect this baby and keep this baby covered and in the right environment and feed them the right information so that they can serve out the purpose that God has for them. And so the first principle is it's a parent's responsibility. The second thing is we must understand is that they should never be denied access to Jesus. So when these parents were bringing their children to the Lord, the Bible says that the disciples began to rebuke them. Now, why would we keep a child away from the Lord? And Jesus' response to this was, and the other text in Mark, it says that Jesus became angry. And so whenever we deprive our children from the experience of getting to know God and to come into knowing who He is and worshiping Him, God is not pleased with it. And He begins to check the disciples. He says, leave them alone. Don't hinder them from coming to me. He says, for such as these belong to the kingdom of God. And so what He was teaching them at the moment is that, you know, it reminds me of that scripture, and a child shall lead them, right? And what He was teaching is that children possesses an humble spirit. And children can show us and remind us of what type of attitude that we must have in being rightly aligned with God. And when we look at children, sometimes we look at them as weak vessels. When we see children, we look at them as being people of no understanding or very little understanding. We despise their youth because we feel that they have not lived long enough to know anything about life. But if you look at the example of a child, you realize because of that truth and that reality, it keeps them humble. Because it's children, when you see them in a household and when they see something that they want to get and they can't reach it, what do? They ask you to get it for them. You see, when a child is faced to pick up something that is heavier than they could do with their own strength, what do? They ask you to pick it up for them. Yeah. But see, the problem with adults is that we think that we know it all, and we think that we can do it all, and so we never call on God to do anything for us. And so Jesus uses these children as a reminder of us of the type of attitude that we must always have before Him. And so in other words, I'm saying is we should never lose our childlike spirit. Amen. We should never lose the idea that we need God, and without God, we will fail. We need God each and every day in our lives to be our provider, to be our protector. Amen. I don't care how many guns that you have in your house. Amen. The scripture says, unless the Lord watches and keepeth over the city, the watcher watcheth in vain. And I don't care how much knowledge you have or how much earthly wisdom that you have accumulated and thinking that you can run your household, you're a man, you beating on your chest like King Kong, and you think you got it all figured out. But the word says, except the Lord builds the house, the labor builds in vain. And I'm trying to tell you that unless you commit your way to the Lord, none of your plans will come to pass. And except your ways pleases the Lord, none of your plans will come to pass. And the way we build and the way you construct your family and whatever you put into your family, if it ain't God, at some point is going to collapse. And that's why Jesus tells the parable of the man who built his house upon a rock versus the one who built his house on the sand. He says, he who hears my word and he what? He do it. He's like the one who builds his house on the rock. Because in our experience, brothers and sisters, I've come to understand that we are all sharing common experiences. We all go through hardship. We all go through pain. There's rain in my life. There's rain in your life. There are storms that come my way, and there are storms that come your way. There are winds that are beating on my house, and there are winds that are beating on your house. But at the end of the day, it is they who wait on the Lord and who rely upon the Lord who will be standing at the end of the day. And it's good to have children around because they remind you of the innocence. They remind you of the purity. They remind you of you know, I need your help. I can't do this by myself. They remind us of the sincerity and sincereness of life. That's what it reminds me of. And the question today is, what would God have you do with your child? I thought about it. One of my favorite entertainers of all time was Michael Jackson. And when Michael Jackson passed away, they began to kind of show you his life. And I began to understand that, you man, Michael Jackson has been before an audience since he was a little bitty kid. He spent his entire life entertaining generations of kids and adults. And he spent his whole life as an entertainer. His father took him and his brothers and he put them on the stage and he trained them. And he was hard on them, because you saw the Michael Jackson story. You know, he was hard on them boys, you know. And Michael spent from the day he stepped into stardom to the day he got called away from here on stage. And then I asked this question, what if we could spend our entire life serving God? What if we could spend every moment of our life from the time that we come into this world to the time God called us home, from them numbers in between that dash in our life, what if we spend the entirety of it serving and worshiping God? I thought about Samuel, Hannah, who gave her son, I believe he's probably 3 years old, and a young boy, and she gave her son to the Lord. And Samuel served as a prophet all the days of his life. Yes, sir. And that's my prayer and hopes for this baby today. Amen. That we will be dedicating to the Lord. Yes. Is that her parents will lend her to the Lord. Yes. And give her to the Lord. Yes. Teach her. Raise her. And that she'll spend every day of her life calling upon his name. Yes. And living for him. Serving him. Amen. God bless you and keep you. This is my prayer. Amen. Amen. As our ushers bring back in our children, we want to now move into the blessing or the dedication of this baby. It is God's will that we bring our children. Lord. And I pray that the word that was shared this morning inspired you, you know, to bring your children, bring your grandchildren, bring your to the Lord. To give them back, because we understand that the Lord has a bigger purpose for them than we do. There are bigger things than being professional athletes. And thinking about all those children, that's the young girls that are participating in the Olympics now. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, you think they just started training for that yesterday? No, many of them been training their whole life for these moments. Amen. And I believe this is the experience that we have to give to our children. We have to train them for it. Amen. Because God is raising up teachers and preachers and leaders among them to impact our society and make this world a better place. Yes, God wants to do that in your children. Sweetheart, God wants to do that in our children, through our children. And so he has put this work into our hands. Amen. Okay, as we all assembled here this morning, I want to now call. We want to make sure we have a couple of microphones for the parents. Utilize that one. Okay. Okay, when they come up, just hand it to them. All right. Y'all had a great day in class? Don't sound like it.
Yes.
Amen. All right, are we ready? Time I want to call the parents and baby Leah to come forward. Uh-oh. She's crying already. Yeah, just give them one. Make sure it's working. Okay. All right. If you stand right here in front of me. Amen. Okay. You can get a little bit closer. All right. Okay. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, today, Chrishell Russell Moore and William Alexander Jr. have come acknowledging and professing their dependence on the Lord to raise their child, Leah Kennedy Alexander. And so now we will do the dedication of vows. Parents, do you come professing Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your lives?
We do.
All right.
Yes. We do.
All right. All right. Amen. Okay, parents, do you come professing Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of your lives?
We do.
And do you dedicate yourselves to biblical instruction, discipline, and love of this child?
Yes.
And do you come to dedicate Leah into the ultimate control and will of God through the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Okay. All right, we want to ask now for the parents and the godparents to come. Godfather on the phone, can he see me? Hey, how you doing? Hey man, can you hear me? Okay, all right, great. Okay, so do you godparents, grandparents, and family support these parents by your example and through acts of service? And do you agree to reinforce the biblical instruction, discipline, and love of this child under the supreme rule of Jesus Christ? If so, you may respond by saying, we do. Amen. Amen. Now I want to pledge the same to our church because she has been born into this church family. Do you, Word of Life Christian Fellowship, agree to support this family, these parents, by your example and through acts of service? And do you agree to reinforce the biblical instruction, discipline, and love of this child under the supreme rule of the Lord Jesus Christ? If so, you may signify by standing. Amen. There's a scripture reading from Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 9. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in your heart. And you shall teach them diligently unto your children. And you shall talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and on your gates." Proverbs 22:6 says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." Amen. And so at this moment, I want to attempt to take baby Leah into my hands. Taking her into my hand is a symbolism of them giving their child to the Lord. Amen. Amen. And as I put her back into the hands of her parents, this symbolizes the Lord entrusting the care of this child into the hand of their parents. Amen. Amen. And now let us bow our heads for prayer of dedication. Father God, we bring this child to you with all our heart, soul, and might. We want to raise this child to love and to serve you. Please help us to be the congregation and parents that will set the right example for this child, and that this child may love you and serve you throughout her entire life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And at this time, we just want to award this dedication certificate that says, "I, Chriselle and William Jr., commit ourselves to the Christian nurture and dedication of Leah Kennedy Alexander at Word of Life Christian Fellowship, as a part of the congregational worship on Sunday, August 11, 2024. Amen. And so at this time, there are two signature spots for the parents, and we want to allow the parents to sign off on this dedication certificate before they dismiss. Amen. And so we want to, someone wants to come. All right. Till my eyes of camera. I'll take a picture. There you go. And so now I present this to you as parents, and I want to say congratulations to you, and I want to commend you for bringing your child, baby Leah, to the Lord. Amen. It is a great thing to do, but I want to remind you that it's not a formality. Amen. It is a duty and a responsibility as parents. And you have committed her to the Lord, and you have entrusted her to the Lord. And my encouragement is to don't hinder her from serving God. Amen. Keep her grounded in the Word. Keep her covered with prayer. Keep her surrounded by Christian influence, biblical influence. Amen. So that she grow up loving God. Amen. Running to God. Amen. And so God bless you and keep you. It's my prayer. Let's give them a hand. Amen. Amen. And I give that charge to the grandparents as well as godparents, uncles. Amen. Big brother. Amen. All of us, the church members, we all have the responsibility. There's a saying, it takes a village to raise a child. And that is so true. Amen. And so we want to guard her with love and protect her. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. Let's give them another hand as they have a seat. Amen. Amen. At this time, we want to just again thank God for the visitation of His Holy Spirit. Thank Him for all that we have experienced here on this morning. And so we would now worship in giving. Amen. We want to praise God and thank Him for those who have already given this week. Thank you for your online contributions. And so behind me on the screen should be the ways that you can give. Amen. Those of you who are watching online, there is also a photo of what you can give or how you can give, amen, to the church, so that we may continue to be obedient to God and continue to use what God has given us for the upbuilding of the kingdom, amen, so that we may continually meet the needs of church and community, amen. And so I think today was a great day. Anybody had a great day today? Yes. Amen. Amen. Those of you who are watching online, did you have a great day today? Amen. I don't know if y'all got to see Brother Meyer. Those of you who are watching online, he's dressed in white. Amen. He looks sharp today. Amen. He looks sharp all the time, but he's extra sharp today. And his wife, Christina, has on white as well. Amen. Those who are visiting with us, thank you for visiting. I'm bad with names. I forgot your name already. I can't hear you. But we thank God for you being with us today. Amen. Mason. Oh, yeah. Mason's dressed in white, too. Look at him. Sharp. Amen. And so I pray that you guys had a wonderful time in your classes today, in that you're learning wonderful things wonderful things in the Lord. And this is the experience we want for all of our children, is to be among the other children and learning about God, learning to love God, learning to obey God, and knowing what God's expectations are for them. Amen? And so let's not keep our children away from God. Jesus get angry about that. Amen. He's like, what are you doing? Don't keep them away from me. All right. So next week we will be out for the first 4 days. We're flying out to Washington, D.C. In celebration of our 27th marriage anniversary. Amen. Praise God for giving me the strength to put up with her for that long. It was hard, Brother Meyer, but the Lord kept me. Nah, I'm teasing. But we just thank God for just sustaining our marriage and allowing us to experience a happy marriage. Amen. And so we thank all of you for your kind wishes and anniversary wishes. And we just want to encourage you this week to, in our absence, just to continue to allow the Lord to use you, continue to work together, continue to encourage each other throughout the week, and join our prayer service on Wednesday night, pray together, and have a great time. And if y'all have any questions, see Deacon Ray or Sister Eloisa, they will have the information that you need. I just need to give it to them. And so they have all the information you need. And so good to see you, Sister Stephanie Bryce. And BJ, is good to see you as well. And all of you who are here, and I don't want to miss anybody, but all of you who are here, God bless you. Just want to thank God for just giving Nana the courage this morning to sing. Amen. She was struggling with it, and a lot of times it's good to just, you know, faith and courage comes sometimes in the midst of fear, you know, and it's like our courage overcomes, our faith overcomes our fear. And courage is being brave enough to do something even when it seems scary. Yes. Amen. And she did that. Amen. And so God bless you. And thank you, Erica, for leading us this morning in worship and even thinking of to utilize her and as this part of the service. Amen. So next week we look forward to our fellowship. And so our children will be a part of the worship experience on next week. And so we encourage parents to work with them on their song, bring them, so that we can have a glorious time in the Lord. Amen. If nothing else, let us stand. We're going to ask Reverend Tommy to come and dismiss us this morning. Amen. Let's bless the Lord as he comes.
Parents on your baby dedication.
Amen.
Got me thinking. I know we're a little behind, but me and my wife ain't getting no sleep. I think that's probably why. A lot of them ain't been dedicated yet. But let us close out with the familiar scripture. It comes from Romans chapter 15, verse 13. And it says, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Amen.
Amen. You're dismissed. Amen. God bless you and keep us, keep you as our prayer. Amen.